All right, I think we'll go ahead and get started. Welcome, everyone. I am Casey Vance. I'm the Executive Director at Ames History Museum, and welcome to our lecture series program tonight. This is the third lecture in our series this year, and I wanted to mention that there are two more. June 8th, which is a Wednesday, Sharon Wirth will talk about the building boom in downtown Ames in the 1920s. And on June 29th, Doug Biggs will talk about the Ames Community School District at the turn of the century. So both of those are coming up, and both of those will be hybrid at the Ames Public Library and also online. So keep an eye out for more information about both of those programs. And I wanted to thank our co-host, Ames Public Library. We're always glad to partner with them, and all of our lectures this year are in partnership with the library. And I will turn it over to Kathy Cooney.
Thanks, Casey. I'm coming to you from the physical Ames Public Library, but welcome to the virtual one as well. And as always, as Casey said, we're thrilled to partner with Ames History Museum. I'm Kathy Cooney. I am an adult services librarian, and the library's mission is to connect you to the world of ideas, which we do through diverse and inclusive resources and programming like tonight's event. So if you have any questions throughout, please submit them through the Q&A or the chat functions, which are linked at the bottom of your Zoom screen, and we'll monitor those to make sure they get shared with our speaker. If you get bumped out of the meeting, please follow the original link to get back to us. And we have enabled live captioning. So if you're not seeing captions, you can click the CC live transcript button at the bottom of your screen in the menu bar and select closed captioning or subtitle. We are also recording this evening's session and we'll post it to Ames History Museum's YouTube channel after the event. You can also find the link to that video and a list of recommended reading related to tonight's theme on our website, amespl.org/history lectures, which I'll pop into that link into chat here in a second. And we'll have time for questions at the end. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to Kathy Speck to introduce our speaker.
I'm pleased to be the coordinator for the annual lecture series. And tonight, we are broadcasting from the African American Museum of Iowa. And the African American Museum of Iowa was founded in 1993 in Cedar Rapids, Iowa, by a small group of members of the Mount Zion Missionary Baptist Church. It is a statewide museum dedicated to preserving, exhibiting, and teaching Iowa's African American history. The current facility was built in 2003, but during the flood of 2008, the museum took on 5.5 feet of water and closed for several months for repair and rebuilding. The museum reopened in 2009 with their current permanent exhibit titled Endless Possibilities. The museum provides tours and programs for all age groups, as well as 20 traveling exhibits. So if you are an organization that would be interested in having an exhibition from the museum, please make an inquiry. The museum is located at 55 12th Street Southeast in Cedar Rapids. Tonight, we welcome the museum's educator, Jenny Barnett, who joined the staff last fall. She manages the museum's educational resources and is responsible for developing public programs and events at the museum and around the state. If you'd like to schedule a group tour or field trip to the museum, do contact Jenny through their website. So I'm turning it over now to Jenny, and welcome.
Thank you so much. I am going to go ahead and stop my video and share my screen so we can get the presentation started. Please let me know if you can't hear. There are lots of videos that we will be watching, so please let me know. I hope technology is on my side tonight. So welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining us tonight for this presentation. This presentation is going to use music to explore African American history, from the African beats to the jazz of the Harlem Renaissance to the popular music of the Civil Rights Movement. The influences of traditional African music can be seen in the spirituals sung by African Americans while they worked as slaves. Elements of spirituals can be found in blues. Blues led the way to jazz. Jazz spurred on R&B, rock and roll, hip hop, and other forms of modern music. Each musical style has ties to history, such as jazz and the Harlem Renaissance or Motown and the Civil Rights Movement. To understand musical history, you have to first take a look behind the beat. Kathy did a great job of giving a little overview of the museum here. The African American Museum, like she said, was started in 1993. There was a group of members of the Mount Zion Missionary Baptist Church that saw that African American history wasn't being taught in our schools here. So what they did is they started a small collection in their church basement that turned into mall exhibits. And then in 2003, a capital campaign was done for our building here. An interesting tidbit of information about the African American Museum. We are actually right on the Cedar River here. And we are going to be a part of a flood renovation project. Part of the flood wall here in Cedar Rapids is going to go through part of our property. So we will be closing temporarily in August to have our flood restoration project begin. Here at the African American Museum, we are guided by our mission to preserve, exhibit, and teach African American history. We have a large collection of documents and physical items that we care for in our collection here on site. We use these to create our exhibits. At any one point in time, we have two exhibits that we have going on. The permanent exhibit, which is Endless Possibilities, that was spoken about a little while ago. And then we also have a temporary annually rotating exhibit. That right now is on redlining. And then while our museum is going to be closed, our next temporary exhibit will actually be housed at the Cedar Rapids Public Library on the third floor. The next temporary exhibit that we have will be on the school to prison pipeline. I can't give much information on that. Our curator is creating that exhibit right now. I know some of the things that she's focusing on are school resource officers in schools and also the disproportionate rate that African-American students and students of color are suspended and disciplined in school. So if you're interested in that, you can check that out at the Cedar Rapids Library, like I said. And we will also have some special temporary exhibits that are traveling exhibits that are going to be available to places. So if you're interested in that, please either reach out to me at the end or you can check out our website for that. And with that, we're just going to go ahead and get started on the presentation. The story of African American music begins in Western Africa. Music was such an integral part of everyday life that many African American languages didn't even have a distinct word for the word music. Without a formal written language, many African cultures passed down history and religion through song. Music was also passed down through oral traditions, and a song might sound a bit different each time a new person performed it. Songs accompanied formal ceremonies like religious rites and war rituals, social functions such as birth or a first tooth, and everyday work and recreation. Music acted as both a form of communication and artistic expression. Though each of Western Africa's many culture groups had its own musical traditions, some elements were shared. Two of the most common, polyrhythm and call and response, appear often in African American musical styles and were used to help people in tandem with one another. There were many instruments used in Western Africa, and what you see on your screen are just a sampling. On your left, this instrument is made of a dried hollow gourd covered with nets of beads or shells. It was played by shaking, tapping the beads, or twisting the net. You would often also see it covered in shells from the coast. The kalimba, or piano, thumb piano, though it has many different cultural names as well, is in the center. It is a common instrument among many different Western cultural African cultures. The keys are usually made of wood or metal, with the body made of a hollow gourd or wooden box. The talking drum on your right is named for its ability to mimic the tones of human speech and originated in Nigeria. To play the drum, one holds it under their arm and hits the drum head. As the player squeezes the drum with varying intensity, the drum changes its pitch. Let's take a look at an expert showing us how it's done. From the 1400s on, African people were taken from Africa as enslaved people. By 1619, some of those people were arriving in North America. From 1619 to 1807, the transatlantic slave trade brought about 500,000 Africans to the United States as slaves. They were forced to leave their homes and become property. Music was one of the few things that enslaved Africans could bring from the old world to the new to retain their unique culture. They used music to express faith, convey sorrow, share experiences, communicate, and aid in their work. Fusing the experiences of life as slaves with African tradition, they created uniquely American musical forms. The two most recognized are songs and spirituals. African Americans' work songs were born on America's plantations and farmlands beginning in the 1600s. Many used repetitive phrases or were performed in the traditional African call and response style. They provided a steady beat that helped enslaved people perform tasks like picking cotton or shucking corn. Work songs could be cheerful, but often they discussed basic needs or unhappiness at the living conditions enslaved people found themselves in. This form of communication through song evolved from the Western African griot or storyteller tradition. Spirituals originated in the late 1700s. Spirituals mixed English with African languages, Christian beliefs with African traditions, and European hymns with secular African-American music. Spirituals often incorporated movement and dance and were more lively than traditional European religious music. Sung in the fields and at home, spirituals express experiences, beliefs, and suffering of the enslaved. It was only after the Civil War and racial slavery ended in 1865 that the music created by enslaved people was recorded in songbooks and introduced to the world by traveling choirs. The first collection of these songs was published in 1867 and included over 130 songs. The book was called Slave Songs of the United States, and it introduced spirituals to the wider audience outside former slave states. However, its publishers eliminated some of the most African qualities of the songs, attempting to conform them to white tastes. The Jubilee Singers from Fisk University in Tennessee were the first choral group to popularize spirituals around the country. The original choir, formed in 1871, consisted of 9 men and women. 7 had previously been enslaved. The group was an international success, performing throughout the world for audiences that included President Grant and Queen Victoria. The recordings you are about to hear is a recording of the Fisk Jubilee Singers from 1909.
Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for the Caribbean.
Though slavery came to an end in 1865, many people of color in the South remained tied to farms and plantations as tenant farmers or sharecroppers. This life was a difficult one, as from the 1870s on, poverty, racism, segregation, racial violence, racial hate groups, and voter suppression all became increasingly threatening. Faced with these grim conditions, many people of color sought refuge and opportunity in new homes in cities and northern states. The first mass movement, the Black Exodus, brought 50,000 African Americans from the South to the Midwest in the late 19th century. An even larger mass movement began in 1910 with the onset of the Great Migration. During World War I, European immigration slowed and many men joined the war effort. This left thousands of vacant industry jobs in cities like New York, Chicago, Philadelphia, and Detroit. African Americans even came to Iowa for jobs in farming, coal mines, and on the railroad. By 1970, 6 million African Americans had migrated north. Enduring the hardships in the South and enduring the changes and new hardships that came in the North led to musical innovation in communities of color. One of the places we see this take place is in religious music. Black church congregations formed after the Civil War can be divided musically into two general groups. Some sought to distance themselves from the roots of slavery and favored traditional European style hymns. Others, however, incorporated traditions from racial slavery into their worship. This included hand clapping, shouting, improvisation, and a form of call and response called lining out. Until the 1930s, the new forms of sacred music developed in Black churches had no official name. They were sometimes called spirituals, jubilees, or church songs. Gospel Pearls is a published volume that contains 165 hymns, church songs, and spirituals, and favorites of the 1920s. It, of course, indicates the name that eventually comes to fruition for these songs, gospel. Mahalia Jackson was known as the Queen of Gospel, along with Thomas Dorsey, a blues pianist who fused ragtime and blues sounds with religious lyrics. She was one of the most influential figures in the golden age of gospel. The song you will hear her sing is How I Got Over, which she sang at the March on Washington in 1963. Though this video is from the march, she had been singing the song and others for decades before the civil rights movement. This brings us to the blues. The exact origins of the blues are a mystery. Historical accounts suggest it was created among sharecroppers, tenant farmers, traveling singers, and jock joints throughout the rural South in the late 1880s. Wherever it began, the blues offered an outlet to share from the artist's perspective the ups and downs of everyday life, including the hardships of life in the South or migration. This music grew into a national phenomenon in the early 1900s, spreading the circuit, early race records, and published compositions. The song you're about to hear is Mamie Smith's 1920 recording of Crazy Blues, which sold over 1 million copies in less than a year and was enshrined in the Grammy Hall of Fame in 1994. Yeah. Alongside the blues was ragtime. The strong beats of ragtime music were born in the rural South, raised in the taverns of St. Louis and New Orleans, and became all the rage in American society from the late 1890s to 1910. Ragtime tunes evoked feelings of excitement and whimsy, and its beat led to looser forms of dance. The pioneers of ragtime music were largely African-American composers like Scott Joplin, James Scott, and Tom Turpin. Scott Joplin sold 1 million copies of the sheet music to his Maple Leaf Rag in just 15 years between 1899 and 1914. James Scott frequently used a call and response style in his works, and we'll hear an example from Frog Legs Rag, his first hit from 1906, in just a moment. In Iowa, we have a small claim in ragtime lore. Though a Missouri native, John William Blind Boone was a nationally recognized pianist and composer, and his compositions are considered an early form of ragtime. In 1883, he took piano lessons in Cedar Rapids from Mary R. Sampson. Shortly thereafter, his career took off. Out of the blues and ragtime arose jazz. Since its birth in the early 20th century, jazz has endured as one of the most popular and influential musical styles. New Orleans is often credited as the birthplace of jazz and was certainly the core development center until the Great Migration took its musicians north in the 1920s. Many of New Orleans' brightest stars moved to Chicago. The city became the center of what would be known as classic or hot jazz, pioneered by jazz greats like Joe King Oliver and Louis Armstrong. One of the most influential figures in the development of jazz and American music as a whole, pictured left. But it was America's youth that made jazz a sensation, using it to express their independence and individuality. Jazz has undergone so many evolutions over the last century that it is difficult to define as a whole. Jazz's trailblazers blended ragtime, masterful instrumentation, and rhythm with the harmonies, vocal effects, and improvisation of the blues. Swinging is one of jazz's most defining characteristics. It refers to playing slightly off tempo, with players typically lagging notes behind the traditional rhythm. Artists use their instruments and voices to create a wide variety of expressive, colorful sounds. The jazz age of the 1920s gave way to several successors in the following decades, including 1930s swing, 1940s bebop, and 1960s free jazz. Iowa has produced several national and internationally known jazz greats, including trumpeter Art Farmer, born in Council Bluffs, Scandia native Eddie Bearfield, the pianist Herbie Hancock, a Grinnell College alumni. The section picture here is of Charlie Parker, Tommy Porter, Porter, Miles Davis, Duke Jordan, and Max Roach. These men are some of the biggest names in bebop, a formerly improvised and fast tempo form of jazz. Over time, jazz evolved. While the 1920s kicked off the jazz age and began the development whose key ideas included things like swing. The 1930s saw swing as a staple of jazz. Then in the 1940s, it was bebop, before further exploration and ideas like free jazz, cool jazz, smooth jazz in the decades to follow. Iowa also had popular spots to catch jazz. The Center Street neighborhood in Des Moines was one of those spots from the 1930s to the 1950s, housing nightclubs that offered visitors of all backgrounds the chance to dance, socialize, and experience the jazz age. circled on the right here, featured local musicians and national names like Josephine Barker, Nat King Cole, Louis Armstrong, and Duke Ellington. It is important to remember that even as Black music was finding success in clubs like those on Center Street, African American composers like Duke Ellington were hailed as great selectively. When the music was done, they were forced to return to their realities of racism and segregation that were still being experienced across the country. In a moment, we'll listen to the ending of Duke Ellington's tune, Black and Tan Fantasy. Black and Tan were clubs where Black and white Americans could enjoy jazz together. Pay careful attention to the musical theme that closes the tune, and you will hear what Mr. Ellington might have thought about the impact these clubs might have. While in segregated neighborhoods and isolated entertainment districts after the Great Migration, Black Americans found the perfect places for the development of new musical styles. The term rhythm and blues was first coined by Billboard in 1948 to replace its race records category. The pulse of rhythm and blues reflected the new urban reality of many African Americans, as did its use of technology. Songs explored the experiences of city life, love, and relationships. On the left is an image of the Orioles, one rhythm and blues group from the 1940s.
If you ever been down to New Orleans, then you can understand just what I mean. Now, all through the week, it's quiet as a mouse, but on Saturday night, they go from house to house. You don't have to pay to use admission if you're the cook or the waiter or the good musician. So if you happen to be just passing by, stopping at the Saturday night fish fry, it was rockin', it was rockin'. You never seen such scuffing and shuffling till the break of dawn.
While some of the earliest records were also considered rhythm and blues, rock and roll grew to be a genre that defined a generation. Beginning in the 1850s, the first wave of post-World War II baby boomers found music that reflected their view of the world and a way to assert their independence. That music was rock and roll. Though the style was eventually dominated by white artists and taken by storm with the British invasion in the 1960s, its roots are African American. Early Black rock and roll pioneers like Little Richard, Chuck Berry, and Bo Diddley provided the genre's foundation in 1950s. In fact, Ike Turner is considered by many music historians to have begun rock and roll with his Rocket 88. Early rock and roll sounds a lot like rhythm and blues with a faster, more energetic beat. This rock and roll sound was pioneered by Little Richard, pictured left, who referred to it as a choo-choo beat, as it was inspired by a train barreling down the tracks. Rock and roll typically features an electric guitar or piano as the dominant instrument. Fats Domino, pictured right, was a rock and roll pioneer pianist. He quickly grew to popularity due to the booming record market. Before the 1920s, popular music was distributed largely through sheet music. Records then began to take over, but sales decreased during World War II due to plastic restrictions. In the 1950s, those sales recovered with force. Between 1951 and 1959, album sales more than doubled, and this directly benefited rock and roll artists. To get a feel for Little Richard's Choo Choo Beat, let's take a listen to Tutti Frutti. Just kidding, my link is gone, I'm sorry. As rock and roll took off, so did the civil rights movement. That said, the first against racial inequality and second-class citizenship spanned centuries before the civil rights movement of the mid-1950s to the early 1970s. From fights for equal voting rights and integrated schooling in the mid-1800s to the Double V campaign in World War II. However, it was the decades following the war that the civil rights movement reached its peak, ultimately gaining national attention in the 1960s. Across the country, people fought to gain equal rights for African Americans through marches like the one in Fort Madison, pictured left. They had protests, sit-ins, boycotts, and rallies. During these protests, people found calls for action and unity, and freedom songs and music became an integral part of the movement. Not only did freedom songs offer hope and solace for those taking to the streets, but they also put the injustice of segregation on full display. Groups like the SNCC Freedom Singers, Core Freedom Singers, and Birmingham Movement Singers spread the civil rights message across the country through song, and We Shall Overcome became one of the anthems of the movement. Let's take a listen to the performance of that song at a reunion of SNCC singers after the movement's conclusion.
We shall overcome, my Lord, we shall overcome, my Lord, we shall overcome, strike down.
While the civil rights movement resulted in several legal and social victories, including the Brown versus Board school integration victory in 1954, the Civil Rights Act of 1964, Voting Rights Act of 1965, and the Fair Housing Act of 1967, many African Americans remained marginalized. For musicians, freedom songs were always an expression of how they were feeling about the events around them. In turn, we find songs ranging from genres and races that reflect the unrest of the era. Let's take a listen to a portion of Nina Simone to understand what some of the musical angst of the era sounded like.
That's just the trouble. Desegregation. Mass participation. Unification.
Now, as some popular artists like Nina Simone began to tackle hard-hitting real-life issues, an alternative arose in pop music in the form of Motown. Founded by Detroit native Berry Gordy, pictured center in 1959, the Motown Record Company boasted an impressive lineup of stars and string of top hits in the 1960s. It was one of the most successful African-American businesses in history, dubbed Hitsville USA, by its founder. The label cranked out stars and songs like a well-oiled assembly line. In fact, Gordy's original concept of Motown derived from his time working in a Detroit automotive factory. The company held weekly quality control meetings, and the polished appearance, stage presence, and persona of a Motown artist was carefully crafted and maintained. The label was designed to appeal to the mass public, old, young, white, and Black. And at the least at the beginning, it was used largely for love songs to make uncontroversial music that would appeal to the masses. The characteristic Motown sound of the 1960s is typically defined as an upbeat or optimistic music. The most common songs were teenage love tunes or romantic ballads and offered catchy melodies with distinct bass and percussion lines. On the left of your screen is the Marvettes. Their hit, Please Mr. Postman, was the first Motown hit to reach number one on the pop charts. Stevie Wonder, a popular Motown artist, is next to them. To the right of Berry Gordy are the Supremes, one of the most popular Motown acts, and finally Marvin Gaye, who is remembered for his love songs and ultimate break from the traditional Motown optimism with What's Going On. A great example of that Motown sound is the number one hit called Please Mr. Postman. Let's take a listen. Stax Records was the Southern counterpart to Motown's pop-flavored tunes, producing music that was grittier and heavily influenced by gospel. Among other historic lineups were Rufus and Carla Thomas, Pictured Right, who provided the first Stax hit, and the iconic Otis Redding, Pictured Left. Let's take a listen to Otis Redding's Try a Little Tenderness. Soul music blurred the lines between sacred and secular by combining elements of gospel music with worldly topics. Soul artists sang about relationships, but are more well known for songs that touched upon political and social issues. Soul is best identified by its close ties to the tradition of African American religious music. Artists borrowed techniques like improvisation, shouting, moaning, and repetition from gospel singers and Black preachers to create the unique sound, soul sound. Singers manipulated their voices to create different tone qualities called timbres. Instrumentalists used technology to create similar sounds. The word soul was associated with several elements of Black culture, such as fashion, language, art, and food. Soul's popularity declined in the late 1970s as funk and disco became more popular and as the optimism of the civil rights movement waned in the face of continued inequality. Ray Charles, Pictured Left, is credited as the first African-American artist to fuse elements of religious music into rhythm and blues. But Sam Cooke, Pictured Right, is credited by many music historians to have officially transitioned from rhythm and blues to soul with his 1964 song, A Change Is Gonna Come. And we're gonna take a listen to that now.
It's been a long, time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will.
was an urban dance music of the late 1960s and 70s. Like all African American music, it provides a window into the Black experience. Funk developed when the optimism and hope of the 1960s, characterized by events like the Civil Rights Movement and Great Society legislation, was overshadowed by the continually worsening conditions of lower class urban African Americans. Funk encourages listeners to embrace and create a unique cultural identity and is well known for artists' elaborate theatrical performances and costumes. James Brown and the Center led the charge to more militant messages in the late 1960s with songs like Say It Loud, I'm Black and I'm Proud. And along with Sly and the Family Stone is credited for laying the foundation of funk.
Some people say we got a lot of malice. Some say it's a lot of nerve. But I say we want to keep moving until we get what we deserve. We've been beaten and we've been scorned. We've been treated bad, talked about as sure as you moan. But just as sure as it takes 2 eyes to make a pair. Brother, we can't quit until we get our share. Say it loud. Say it loud. One more time. Say it loud.
Just as funk began to know, despite the legal and social gains of the civil rights movement, Black Americans still were not experiencing equality and had to continue to fight for equal opportunity. Reforms enacted by the Voting Rights Act of 1965 allowed more African Americans to vote, and in turn led to more African Americans elected into political office with the Congressional Black Caucus formed in 1971. While the caucus has grown and we've seen great representation in some of the nation's highest offices, including the presidency and now the vice presidency, disenfranchisement remains an issue to this day, with a sizable portion of the adult Black population unable to vote due to felony convictions. Many of those conditions came in the wake of the war on drugs. Though the Black middle class grew rapidly in the 1970s and 80s, the quality of life for those in lower classes worsened. Segregation still existed in the country's cities, not in law, but in practice. And the economy in those segregated communities suffered as jobs moved overseas. Then the highly addictive crack cocaine invaded urban centers as a cheap substance that was highly addictive. Those struggling were around it, and some saw it as a business opportunity or an escape. It led to increased trafficking and increased violence as gangs got involved in sales. This only worsened the conditions in these neighborhoods. But out of these hardships rose hip hop. In the 1970s and the early 1980s, a new youth culture called hip hop was created in the Bronx, one of New York City's 5 boroughs. By this time, it was clear to many African Americans that the legal gains of the civil rights movement had not led to true equality. Participants of hip hop culture sought to overcome these obstacles by creating a self-defined culture of language, music, clothing, and art. This established a framework for achieving status through non-traditional channels. The foundation of early hip hop culture was built upon 4 pillars: graffiti writing, DJing, MCing, and breakdancing. Each element influenced the others, a tradition highlighted in 1980s hip hop cinema. Graffiti writing is, of course, anonymous street art, most typically executed in spray paint. It originated in the 60s and early 70s and became more elaborate over time as artists strove to create recognizable identities and achieve prestige. Train cars became popular canvases due to their size and moving nature, but this art was often used to decorate neighborhoods. By the mid-1970s, public officials viewed graffiti as a cause of the degrading quality of life and spent millions of dollars unsuccessfully trying to end the practice. DJing originated in the mid to late 1970s in the South Bronx. Innovators like Kool Herc, Grandmaster Flash, and Afrika Bambaataa and DJ Breakout created a new style of music by manipulating turntables, sampling old songs, and mixing tracks. MCing originated in the late 1970s. As DJing increased in complexity, MCs were added to capture the crowd's attention. Over time, these rappers asserted showmanship, leadership, and identity for their crews. They used stage names to create persona with flash and style. They also looked to the Black traditions of boasting, toasting, signaling, and playing the dozens competitive or recreational insults to guide their art. In 1989, it was Sugar Hill Gang's Rapper's Delight that truly kicked off this phenomenon. We'll take a listen in a moment. Finally, as this music was created, breakdancing took off. The term refers to a style of dancing characterized by elaborate footwork, freeze poses, acrobatic moves, and jerky but fluid movement. Its development was likely influenced by 1970s dance crazes like the robot and evolved during extended breaks between songs at house parties or clubs. As hip hop developed, DJs created break beats for dancers by repeatedly looping rhythmic tracks. The hip, the hip, to the hip, hip, hop, you don't stop the rocket to the bang, bang, boogie, say up, jump the boogie to the rhythm of the boogie to beat. Now what you hear is not a test, I'm rapping to the beat. And me, the groove, and my friends are gonna try to move your feet. You see, I am Wonder Mike, and I like to say hello. Up to the black, to the white, the red, and the brown, the purple, and yellow. But first, I gotta bang, bang, the boogie to the boogie, say up, jump the boogie to the bang, bang, boogie, let's rock. You don't stop, block the rhythm, that'll make your body rock. Over time, hip-hop would evolve. Old-school rap was party-oriented, while new-school rap focused more on political and social messages. In the 1990s, the most prominent style was gangster rap, a West Coast form that explored the harsh realities of urban life, such as drugs, gangs, and police brutality. Rap had become the most prominent of hip-hop's four founding elements. Some even consider it to be the separate, highly commercialized entity. To get a feel for the way these artists talk about the world around them, as those that came before them did, let's take a listen to Changes by Tupac.
I see no changes, all I see is racist faces. Misplaced hate makes disgrace the racist. We under, I wonder what it takes to make this one better place, let's erase the wasted. Take the evil out the people, they'll be acting right. It's both black and white, and smoke a crack tonight. And the only time we chill is when we kill each other. It takes skills and we real time to heal each other. And although it seems evident, we ain't ready to see a black president. It ain't a secret, don't conceal the fact. The penitentiary's packed and it's filled with blacks. But some things will never change. Try to show another way, but it's staying in the dope game. Now tell me what's a mother to do. Being real don't appeal to the brother in you. You gotta operate the easy way.
I made a G today,
but you made it in a sleazy way. Sell it back to the kids.
I gotta get paid.
Well, hey, well, that's the way it is.
Come on, come on.
That's just the way it is. Things will never be the same. That's just the way it is. Oh yeah.
The Black community did not stop innovating after hip-hop, though. Neo-soul emerged in the 1990s as an alternative to hip-hop. As the name suggests, the style was a rebirth of soul music heavily influenced by spoken word poetry. In contrast to much of early hip-hop, neo-soul was historically been dominated by women and presented the gender in a positive light. The style is still popular today, featuring artists like Jill Scott, Anthony Hamilton, and musical Soul Child. This song that you're about to listen to is called So Gone by Jill Scott.
Don't want this thing, but can't let go. Even though I need it so. Your arms, they soothe me, but I ain't no game. I ain't no tie, I ain't just brain. This ain't no movie, man.
It In addition to the styles presented, Black musicians have continued to alter styles of the past and to participate in styles that did not originate with Black artists as well. Today, we see Black artists in soul and R&B and hip hop, rock, rap, jazz, blues, and more. A perfect way to round out this program seems to be using Childish Gambino's This Is America as a way to dissect the modern Black artists discuss the world around them. This Is America was released in 2018 and portrays what America has come from and is today from Childish Gambino's perspective. We will be watching and analyzing the video, and this does have some harsh language in it and graphic violence is depicted. At this time, if this is not for you, you're welcome to turn off your screen or step away. But I do encourage you to stick around because then the video comes to an end. We will be looking at some of the music historians have argued is being presented through the content. One of the first depictions we see in the video is a contortion of Childish Gambino's face and body into some weird positions. It has been widely argued by music and art historians that this is his way of attempting to represent some of the stereotypical imagery to represent people of color as less than, unintelligent, individuals incapable of caring for themselves. We understand that this was a hateful imagery unfounded in any reality, but is permeated in American society for many decades and is represented by Childish Gambino to open his work. We see multiple representations of violence against people of color in this video as well. Early on, we see a guitar player murdered. When this happens, his body is left to lie on the ground while the gun is carefully whisked away and fabric protected. Later, we see a church choir slain in an act of gun violence. Again, the gun is taken away and fabric protected, but those that are killed are left to lay on the ground. This has been argued to be a statement about America's priorities related to bodies and lives of colors and firearms. The church choir scene has also been suggested to relate to the Dylann Roof shooting at a church in Charleston that resulted in the death of 9 churchgoers and the injury of 1. Later, we see Childish Gambino say, "This is a celly, that's a tool." The camera then pans to folks holding cell phones on a structure that resembles a cell block. This has been argued as a double meaning. Since tool is sometimes used to mean weapon, a cell phone can be used as a weapon, capturing acts of violence against people of color, and has been mistaken for a weapon by police and led to the deaths of Black African Americans. And through the war on drugs, cell blocks have been disproportionately used to imprison people of color, removing them from neighborhoods, cities, and society. At another moment in the video, Childish Gambino depicts a horseman riding out in front of the police squad car. Since the horsemen are signs of the apocalypse and biblical reference, many experts have argued that this is an argument by Childish Gambino that the police have been a tragic deterrent in communities of color. Eventually, we see Gambino light a substance and smoke it at the top of a car. When he does this, the chaos around him goes away. This has been argued as either a symbol for the war on drugs, with the introduction of substances like crack cocaine leading to the removal of many from their neighborhoods, leading to quiet, or as a symbol or explanation of the use of substances as a way to make the challenges and strife faced by people of color go away, if only for a while. Childish Gambino ends the video running through darkness. This image harkens to many historical events and moments, like the Underground Railroad, like those who left racial violence in the South, and like those persisting in the face of injustice. Some experts have argued that this acts as a commentary on an ongoing struggle, one where when progress comes, new hardships follow, falling to an outgoing sprint through darkness. Though this is not the take that everyone agrees upon. Ultimately, through the work of Childish Gambino, we see that we have seen through all of the styles of music we've discussed today. Artists are innovative to tell their narrative of the world around them. So this is an explanation, an observation, an escape, an argument, or something else entirely. Thanks for joining us as we reviewed the Black contributions in music today. At this point, I'll do my best to answer any questions that anyone might have.
Thank you so much, Jenny.
Yeah, a lot.
I am not seeing any questions at the moment.
Okay.
Oh, somebody said in the Childish Gambino video, do you have any insight on why the dancers were in school uniforms?
I don't have an answer for that. I'm sorry.
Oh, here's a great question. Do you have a personal favorite genre of the ones you covered?
Oh my goodness, do I have a personal favorite? Oh my, no one has ever asked me that. I would have to say the gospel music. I really like gospel music. It touches me personally. What about you, Rick?
Do we have any other questions? Oh, here's some in the Q&A. Oh, Rick said he's listening to Motown after we log off, especially Marvin Gaye.
Okay.
Somebody asked, has Childish Gambino made any comments regarding the interpretation on his video?
I'm not sure. This presentation was created by our previous museum educator, so I'll have to look up some more information on that song specifically and the artist.
All right, I'm not seeing any other questions coming in, so thank you so much again, Jenny, for the great presentation.
Yeah.
And we hope to see all of you again at the museum or the library soon, or the African American Museum of Iowa.
Yes, before August.
There you go. Thank you.
Thank you so much.